Hi everyone. For today, we'll be talking about ethics, and the discussion will revolve around security ethics or cybersecurity ethics. My name is Justin Pineda, and we'll run through the topics for discussion today. So, let's define what is ethics, because regardless what discipline we're in, we come to this topic, and we have discussions on ethical standards in a particular domain like medicine or law and others as well. So ethics by definition is describes the expected behavior of the members from a high-level standpoint. So we talked about the standards, the expected actions and behaviors of members, and usually it's per organization type. So if you're or per per organization or profession, so you have ethics or code of ethics for teachers, for doctors, for lawyers, for software developers, and so on. And usually it's high level, so it talks about all the expected behaviors, all the expected actions that should be done by members. So one of the example would be the ISE squared code of ethics. So if you're have taken if you have taken the CISSP or similar certifications or certifications that were created by ISE squared, then you will see this. And again, it's very high level. So first is protect the society, the commonwealth, and the infrastructure, act honorably, honestly, justly, responsibly, and legally, provide diligent and competent service to principals, and advance and protect the profession. So very high level, might be applicable to other professions, other organizations, but it sums up the expected behavior of the members, especially because this is for information security. Now, another code of ethics here would be coming from SANS. So the SANS Institute IT Code of Ethics. So SANS is another reputable organization focused focusing on cybersecurity. So these are the summary of its code of ethics. I will strive to know myself and be honest about my capability. I will conduct my business in a manner that assures the IT professional is considered one of integrity and professionalism, and I will respect privacy and confidentiality. Very straightforward, high level, but it resonates to every member, and is applicable to any activity that you will be doing. Now, why are we discussing about ethics? Why is it important? We know in security there's such thing as ethical hacking, right? Because we want to simulate how potential attackers will target your specific organization, and you want to simulate it so that you can help the organization protect the infrastructure from these attacks. Now, one interesting topic in ethics would be the concept of the ethics of hacking back. So I read this paper. It's a policy paper by Dr. Patrick Lean. So, and it makes sense. This makes sense because there are instances, or there were instances before, where organizations try to respond to an attack in order for their data to be saved, to be restored, or to be stopped from being leaked. And the process that they do is to hack back. So let's define what hacking back is. All right, so hacking back is an active cyber defense. So it is not an unprovoked first strike, but a counter response to an attack. So it means you did not initiate it first, but you are responding to it. So the third bullet says, even if it is defensive, it is offensive in nature. Okay, because you're doing something active, like we'll see the examples later on, but it's not just to stop an attacker. So you will do something active for you to gain access to a data, to stop an attack by doing denial of service and so on. So it's not just laying down your defense. Okay. So here are some of the examples. So an organization can collect information or trace the theft back to a particular system. So tracing may require some tools to identify where the traffic came from, what were the hubs used, and so on. So it may require recording of information or planting of surveillance. So that's the first one. Number two, you break in the attacker's machine to delete the stolen data. Right? So you are hacking back in effect because you're not supposed, or you're not authorized to break into somebody else's computer or machine. Number three, accessing attacker's webcam to send back photos for evidence. And that's another, which again is considered hacking because you are accessing the attacker's webcam. And then the last would be embedding a malware in a sensitive data and locking the attacker's computer. So this is a counter or a reverse Uno card. You are you plant a ransomware in the sensitive data that once it's executed, it will encrypt the machine of that whoever opens it. So these are some of the many possible examples. And when we talk about who could potentially, or why would you do that, why would organizations do that, it would be because there are attacks in CIA, confidentiality, integrity, and availability. But what are the problems, or what are the main issues here? The controversy here, okay, the first one is the same laws that prohibit to hack make it illegal to hack back. Like for example, in the United States, there is a law called Computer Fraud and Abuse Act, or the CFAA, enacted in 1986. And in summary, it says that if you make an unauthorized access or create a malicious application harming the machine, then you are liable and you can be prosecuted and penalized, go to jail. So when you do the same thing, when you do hakbang, you are potentially or technically you are breaking the same law. And you're making an unauthorized access, or you are you are creating a malicious application or malicious software, harming the offender's machine. But the counterpoint here is that the laws did not have hackback in mind when they created it, so which makes it more interesting. Okay. Now, Dr. Patrick Lin presented 6 arguments for this ethics of hackback. The first is the argument from the rule of law. The second is the argument from self-defense. Third is argument from attribution. Fourth would be argument from escalation. And the fifth would be the argument from public health. And the last would be the argument from practical effects. So let's go to the first one. All right. So the first argument here is the argument from the rule of law. And it says here that the state has a legal monopoly of violence. What does it mean? If there is a conflict between two parties, you do not put the law in your hands. Instead, you have to reach out to the government, to the law enforcement agencies, to referee on your behalf. So they would take action and would require, you know, and would, if they are required to use force, then they would do so, right? But that's the default setting. You have to engage the law enforcement authorities first. So it says that the state is based on a social contract among citizens to renounce their natural liberty to use force against one another. They transfer that power to the state itself. However, third bullet, if the state fails in this duty with respect to a particular threat, the entire social contract is not necessarily voided, but the state's monopoly on violence could be apportioned back to citizens to defend ourselves. What does it mean? For physical security issues like robbery or theft, obviously, we ask help from law enforcement authorities or agencies to intervene. However, in the cyber world, in most cases, law enforcement authorities there are understaffed and could not respond to all of the cyber crimes reported. And that's a reality. So what would happen if that's the case? And one of the excerpts here is that it's actually comparing the cyber world to if you're living in an island, in a very isolated island, and you have pirates going there to that island, and there are no police, but you have your gun, but you have your weapons. So what, and because there's nobody who will respond, will help you out, of course, you'll have to defend yourself, right? So that's what is being argued here in the rule of law. John Locke says that the reason dictates that we ought to be guided by first our duty to protect and sustain ourselves, and then when not in conflict with our own survival, our duty to protect and sustain others. Now, let's go to the second argument. Argument from self-defense. Now, hacking back is based on a natural right to defend one's own person and property. So, according to most criminal laws, it would depend on the circumstances or when your safety is in question. So even the UN Universal Declaration of Human Rights would say that everyone has the right to life, liberty, and security of person. No one shall be subjected to arbitrary interference with his privacy, family, home, correspondence, nor to attacks upon his honor or reputation. Okay, so everyone has the right, if I'm going to use the argument, I have the right to the protection against such interference or attacks. Now, on the other hand, okay, again, what it's saying here is that, for example, there is a somebody break into your property, to your home. Okay, the right response here may be to summon law enforcement to your aid and not to take matters into your untrained hands. Even if you have the weapon, the training will always be call the police, not to confront the attacker. No? So that's the last option. But if you have the option 1, 2, 3, the first one would be to call the enforcement. But again, as what was mentioned in the first argument, in a cyber intrusion, law enforcement is unlikely to rescue you in the event of a cyber attack. So the justification does not make a criminal use of force lawful. If the use of force is justified, it cannot be criminal at all. So that's the argument from self-defense. And if no law is broken, then the rule of law cannot be threatened. Which makes sense again. And let's go to the third argument. The argument from attribution. When we say attribution, what does it mean? You need to know who is attacking you to ensure you are not retaliating against an innocent party, which would seem fundamentally unjust. Like, if there's a DDoS targeting your organization and botnets are used, so you would register all the IPs. You would see that this DDoS attack came from these IPs and you plan to retaliate. Now, the problem or the issue here is that are you sure that these are really the attackers or are they also the victims? Or are you going to, because it's still very broad, you're going to target random IPs, you might be hitting innocent innocent users. So that is the argument from attribution. But the counter argument here would be, is clear attribution a necessary precondition for hacking back? Now, like here in this example, if somebody was coerced to conduct suicide bombing or armed robbery, so when that's the case, police are not expected to ascertain a person's identity and motives before using a lethal force against him or her to prevent a worse outcome. So there is no need to establish the guilty mind or what we call the mens rea. So can victim be in a better position to judge attribution and respond? So the argument is saying is that attribution may be too strict a requirement, especially when a rapid reaction is needed. And for cyber attacks, rapid reaction is really needed. It's required because when something strikes, time is of the essence that you have to either shut down the machines right away, right? Trace the IP right away so that you can do further action. So if we're going to require attribution, then we may lose a lot of opportunities collecting data, collecting evidence, collecting artifacts, and saving the data if needed. So that's the argument from attribution. Now, the next is argument from escalation. Argument from escalation states that when there's an attack and it comes from abroad, it may be considered as a war crime or it may be an act of war, sorry, it may be an act of war, right? If like for example, if you suddenly fire missiles targeting a neighboring country, it may be an act of war. So that's the argument from escalation. So hacking back against a foreign target may be misinterpreted by the receiving nation as a military response from our state to serious political and economic backlash. So it may be considered that. So all members, according to the UN Charter Act, Article 2, all members shall refrain their international relations from the threat or use of force against the territorial integrity or political independence of any state or in any manner inconsistent with the purposes of the United Nations. So that's the argument. But international cyber attacks have been ongoing for more than two decades without too much escalation or actual war. So it's considered to be, you know, being bumped in a crowd. It's treated as normal, even if you're of different races. Argument from escalation. Now, the next is the argument from public health. So the fifth argument is the argument from public health, wherein cybersecurity is likened to a public health issue, and that cyber attacks are considered a plague upon the public good of online life. So what it's saying here is that it's up to the users, to the organizations, to hold the line against an outbreak that may revert back to us. So in the case of hacking back, it's like fighting the plague to ensure that everybody is safe and healthy. Right. And the last argument is the argument from practical effects. So the question here is hackback practical or effective? Would it deter or discourage attackers? What if the attackers are ideological attackers, hacktivists? Would it work? Is it practical if they have their own cause? Or would it dissuade cyber criminals from doing cyber crimes? Potentially, yes. No? So it has to be weighed in whether it is practical with the effort that you're going to do, with the results that you're going to get. But one of the things that stood out in this argument is that hacking back does not follow the normalcy of security. And in security fundamentals, it's always about protection, building defense in depth, layers of defense, and making sure that you have prevent detect response controls and so on. But there is no hackback control, right? That's why it emphasizes here that it does not follow the normalcy of security. Now, one of the key takeaways here is the lack of technical know-how. So this is a challenge, not only I think in the Philippines but in other countries. No? Okay. So how do we educate? How do we educate regulators, policymakers about the importance of securing the cyber world and at the same time ensuring that they understand the process of handling artifacts and preserving evidence and making sound judgments based on technical details that we are providing. No. Now, in this argument, it says that there is an opportunity for regulation and judicial oversight. Of course, the concept is controversial, as as with the other national issues, right? But there has to be regulation. The government must intervene, study the pros and the cons, and put it into writing. To what extent would it be allowed to hack back? And if yes, in what instances? At what points? Right? If in the previous arguments we say that law enforcement might not be present right away in the cyber world, in the online world, will that give us the license to do hackback? And how severe can we go? Right? Or how far can we go? And the last point here is the rule of law is important, and the purpose of law is not only to prohibit but also to empower, which is very important. Now, these are the six arguments presented in the policy paper of Dr. Patrick Lin. And there are a lot of similar cases that talk about hacking back, right? to save data, to save data subjects, personal information, PII, SPI, sensitive personal information. But how do we go about this? Because if there is no clear documentation, there is no black and white documentation, then even the organizations who have the tools might be discouraged to being proactive because of the potential ramifications. So how about you guys? What do you think? Is hacking back something that would be helpful for organizations, for society in general? Or is this too much for organizations to do, and we should just rely to law enforcement agencies and the government to do their job? And so it's a good point of discussion during synchronous and group sessions. Okay, so that's it. So this wraps up the discussion on ethics, and for the exercise, there will be cases that we will be discussing, and it will revolve around hacking back. Okay, so thank you, and have a nice day.